Now on 2GB, Ben Fordham Live, Sydney's best breakfast.
Morning, it's Tuesday, July 27. This is Ben Fordham on 2GB, the 5:30 Club, open for business. Thanks for being with us. Thanks for waking up early. Our number 131873. Ben at 2GB.com if you'd like to send a text. And you can, that's the email, isn't it? Ben at 2GB.com is the email. And the text line 0460 873 873. A bit like when you say to someone, hey, what's your phone number? And they say, I don't know. I never need to call myself. Do you notice that? Once upon a time, you knew all of your phone numbers off by heart. I can even tell you our first home phone number. I won't give it to you now because someone will try calling it and wake someone up. But yes, Ben at 2GB.com. That's the email. And the text is 0460 873 873. Now, weather-wise, sunny in the city today, mostly sunny in the west. The chance of fog in the west this morning. Right now, it's 12 degrees on the coast. It's 10 in Parramatta, 7 in Penrith. Richmond is 8, Campbelltown's 5, North Sydney 12, Bankstown 7, and it's 13 on the central coast. The sun will be up at 8 minutes to 7. Well, how good's Ariane Titmus, the new queen of the pool? The Aussie won gold in the women's 400 freestyle. She's back in the pool this morning in the semi-finals of the 200 freestyle, and everyone's going to be watching. It was fantastic yesterday. It was real edge-of-your-seat stuff. And Basil Zemplis, who called the 400 freestyle, I just thought he was fantastic. So was Ian Thorpe. The commentary team on Channel 7 has been outstanding. And Ariane Titmus knocked off the American champion Katie Ledecky, who was previously undefeated at the Olympics. You know, there was a journalist who wrote a piece in the lead-up to this saying, does anyone honestly believe they can knock off our Katie? Well, yes, Ariane did. Ledecky led for most of the race, but Titmus hit the lead just at the right time, 50 metres to go. She didn't look back. She won by 0.67 of 1 second. And what about the coach, Dean Boxall? He just went nuts. He's now been warned for ripping off his mask and going berserk. And she's only 20, originally from Tasmania. They moved to Queensland because they wanted to be closer to the coach, Dean Boxall. And he's a tough operator. He takes no prisoners. We'll talk to Dawn Fraser a little later on, who was celebrating with Ariane's mum and dad, Robin and Steve, yesterday. And yes, she's back in the pool this morning in the semis of the 200 freestyle. In the rest of the swimming, Emma McKeon finished with bronze in the 100 butterfly, so that was a personal best. Australia won bronze in the men's 100 metre relay, and the final leg from Kyle Chalmers was phenomenal, taking us from fifth to third. He's favourite for the individual event. And there are some stories that are just mind-blowing about athletes young and old. Imagine being a gold medalist at 13. Well, Japan's Nishiya Momiji won the skateboarding at just 13, and another 13-year-old won silver. And then you've got a 48-year-old Australian mother of two who's competed at 6 Olympic Games now. She's from Melbourne. I was watching her yesterday in the women's table tennis. She's unbelievable. Jian Fanglei. She's through to the third round. 48 years of age, a mother of two at her 6th Olympic Games. And yes, if we need something to distract us at the moment from COVID, the Olympic Games have come along at the perfect time. Just fantastic. And I loved sitting down yesterday and playing back Ariane Titmus to my children and explaining to them, this girl from America in the black cap, she's the best in the world. They reckon she can't be beaten, but this is our girl, the Aussie. Just watch her go. And even though it was on replay, it was just amazing watching it over and over. Now, we better get down to business with COVID. There are concerns for anyone who visited the Campsie Centre shopping mall any time between July 14 and July 24. The centre has been visited by a confirmed case. Transmission has already been detected. If you were there between those dates, you must get tested and isolate for 14 days, regardless of the result. So that's the Campsie Centre Shopping Mall between July 14 and July 24. And restrictions in some parts of Sydney could be tightened even further. Senior ministers spent about 5 hours meeting yesterday trying to figure out the next steps. It's understood they've looked at plans to tighten restrictions in areas of southwest Sydney while potentially easing them in other locations. Sources say decisions are expected to be made today. The vaccine rollout is getting a boost in the southwest. 4 new walk-in clinics will be set up across Merrylands and Guildford for the next 3 weeks, offering AstraZeneca to people aged 40 and over. Bookings and GP referrals are not required, and Pfizer vaccines will also be prioritised for supermarket workers from southwest and western Sydney. My number 131873. You can email ben@2gb.com. And the text line's up and running. You know what we're up to. So what are you up to this Tuesday morning? Day 32 of lockdown, 0460 873 873. We've got $1,000 cash to give away this morning, and I want to give it to you. The first code word you need to know is sailor. S-A-I-L-O-R. Sailor. Like someone who sails around on a boat or a yacht. A sailor. The word sailor is your first cash code word. There's a second one coming up a little later on. Keep on listening for your chance to win. Good morning. 14 minutes to 6 o'clock, 131873, the open line number. Sunny in Sydney today, mostly sunny in the west. The chance of fog in the west early this morning, tops of 21 or 22. At the moment, it's about 12 on the coast and 10 degrees in Sydney's west. Now, Canberra, partly cloudy, 15 today. Brisbane, sunny and 23. Melbourne, windy, a possible late shower, 17. Perth, you've got showers, a possible storm, and 18. Adelaide's mostly clear and 19. Hobart, a shower or two, a top of 14. And Darwin, clear today and a top of 33. Here's a thought to kick off your day. The comeback is always stronger than the setback. Day 32 of lockdown. The comeback is always stronger than the setback. Maybe I've got a little bit more inspiration flowing through my veins because I've got vaccine flowing through my veins as well. I've now got the second jab. I had it yesterday afternoon, so I'm fully vaccinated. I must admit, I had a little bit of a restless sleep, a little bit cold overnight, a little bit of an ache, only really minor, not enough that I needed to take a Panadol or anything. But it feels good to be fully vaxxed. Mind you, I know a lot of other people are waiting. There are plenty of people in queues, and I'll get to some of the latest numbers there in just a moment. I just want to mention that this is a big one for Anthony Albanese because he was facing a bit of a nightmare when it comes to several policy fronts. He's decided to sort a few of them out, probably while half the country is locked up and focused on COVID. Anthony Albanese has decided to take a different path to his predecessor, Bill Shorten. So first, he's agreed to back the Stage 3 income tax cuts. That's despite saying for months they were too generous to people on high incomes. So he's now backing Stage 3 income tax cuts, which is a wise move because you don't want to stand between Aussies and a tax cut at election time. And he's borrowed a line from Kevin Rudd. He says he wants to deliver for working families, and that means giving them stability and certainty. Second, he's dumped Bill Shorten's policy of cracking down on negative gearing and capital gains tax concessions. And third, there will be no changes to franking credits. Instead, Albo says he wants to crack down on multinationals. He wants Facebook and Google to pay more tax. So that brings him into line with a push by some of the world's biggest economies for a global tax rate of 15%. That would apparently prevent massive companies avoiding billions of dollars in tax, because at the moment what they say is, all right, if you want to tax us, we'll just go somewhere else. The idea is if you get all the world's biggest economies on the same page, it'll be harder for those big companies to sidestep the tax.
This is Ben Fordham Live with Sydney's Best Breakfast on 2GB 873.
It's 10 to 6. The vaccination figures are concerning for the 50s and 60s age bracket. And this comes from Dr. Kerry Chant, the Chief Health Officer in New South Wales. She says it's quite distressing to see how few over 60s we've managed to reach. So here's the number. 14.5% of everyone aged 50 to 69 have had both doses of the vaccine. 14.6% of those in the 50 to 69 age bracket. Vaccination rates are higher for people over 70 and people in their 40s. Overall, 22% of everyone aged 50 plus have had both doses. So you've got to wonder whether the lower number for those aged 50 to 69 is because of the mixed messaging around AstraZeneca. They've changed the settings about 3 or 4 times. And if you did that with a motor car, said, look, we've got a safety rating, but we've changed it 4 times in 6 months. Well, there'd be a few people thinking, maybe I'll choose another model. Maybe I'll wait until they've ironed out any of the concerns. And that's despite the fact that we know you're a greater chance of dying from a lightning strike or a shark attack than any health complications associated with AstraZeneca. Steve's called in. Steve, good morning to you.
G'day, Ben. How you going?
Good, mate. You've had the jab?
Yeah, I had my first jab yesterday. I've been one of these hesitant people for a while. And I just thought, what the hell? I thought about it over the weekend. Turned up at Belmore Pharmacy yesterday on my bike, and I looked at the sign, and the sign said, COVID vaccinations here. Turned out it was their first day of giving the jab, so I got it. No queue, no waiting around, no appointment, just got in.
Oh, nice, well, mate, well done, well done. So one down, one to go.
Yeah, yeah, and can I just say that that negative gearing, whether they take it or leave it, a lot of us don't have mortgages, you know, we're just renters, so that isn't a big motivating thing, really.
No, well, it certainly is for those people out there who are property owners, and I've got a real estate update coming from our money man, Peter Switzer, after 6:30 this morning that will just blow your mind when you consider what one major bank has now forecast property prices to do over the next 12 months. Massive, massive growth. They're talking about 20% over the course of 2021. And that's from the National Australia Bank. 20%. They say it'll slow to 3% growth next year, but still 21% growth this year. We'll catch up with our money man, Peter Switzer, after 6:30 this morning. 131873, the open line number, ben@2gb.com if you'd like to email, and you can text 0460 873 873. I wanted to say good morning to a friend of the program, Wallace Edwards, who we came into contact with a number of years ago, a bloke who's done so much for Rotary, and the Rotary Club in St Ives has let us know that sadly Wally's taken a bit of a turn in his health. He's in palliative care. He's 104 years old, Wallace Edwards. Mr. Edwards, if you're listening, or if someone who knows you is listening, please pass on our love to Wallace Edwards, 104 years of age, and a bloke who's done so much for his community through Rotary and other charitable pursuits over 104 years. He was also the welfare officer at the Hardboard Diggers. And we've got some news for people when it comes to hitting that magic number 100. More of us are doing it. Researchers say Aussies are entering a new era where remaining healthy well into our 90s and beyond is much more common. Between 2000 and 2020, the number of Aussies aged over 85 grew by 110%. A baby girl born today has an almost 40% chance of reaching 100. And then there's the age-old question, what's the secret to a long, healthy life? Researchers from the University of New South Wales say there are a few common traits: regular physical activity, engaging in social groups, a healthy plant-based diet, close relationships with family, and a strong motivation to get up every single day. So what's your motivation for getting up and cracking into it? 100. Are you going to get there? Am I going to get there? Who knows? And some of the time I think, oh, I want to live till I'm 110. And other times I think, I don't know. I think I'll get my job done a little earlier and then say goodbye. But anyway, there's some encouraging news for those who want to go 100 and beyond. And we just lost Australia's oldest man recently. So if you've got that target in mind, chances are you might just get there.
You're listening to Sydney's Best Breakfast, Ben Fordham Live. And now, a sports update.
James Willis, what about Ariane Titmus? Wasn't she fantastic?
Well, Ben, I've got to be honest. I would never cry in a movie like The Notebook or Notting Hill, but I was blubbering like a baby.
I had a few tears too.
Because it just the escape of something like this, and we saw it with Ash Barty a few weeks ago, but you know, to knock off the greatest female swimmer ever, this was one of the great victories in the pool. And 5 years in the making, I loved the energy of this coach, Dean Boxall. I mean, like, you know, he almost fell out of the grandstand, but he did that in the trials as well. He runs up and down the pool and he's urging her on and getting her across those times. He's brutal on his swimmers. A lot of people can't cop that, but Titmus thrives off it and she's improved out of sight to win a massive gold medal.
Craig Bellamy staying with the Storm.
Yeah, he's told Cronulla he won't be taking up their offer for next year. He'll be head coach at Melbourne next year, and then there'll be a succession plan over 3 or 4 years for him to move into director of football. Next year's his 20th year as Melbourne Storm coach.
We'll catch up next hour.
Thanks, Ben.
James Willis there. I mentioned Australia's oldest man passing away recently. That was Dexter Kruger, who died at the age of 111. You're listening to Ben Fordham on 2GB. News is coming up next at 6 a.m.
People you know. Opinions that matter. News you can trust. This is Breakfast with Ben Fordham on Sydney's 2GB.
131873, the open line number if you'd like to be part of the show. Raymond says, great to have you with us this time of the morning. With the lockdown, the positivity is most welcome for us in Voyager Point. And then you've got Sean, who's at Mystery Bay in the far south, just getting ready for a morning surf. With a warm coffee, not a speck of wind. Looks like an awesome day. And Rama says, nice to hear you. I'm up and getting ready for work. I'm a disability support worker. I've got a big day ahead. I had my 2 doses of AstraZeneca. I'm absolutely all right. Thank God. Have a great day, dear friend. Good on you, Rama. Thank you very much. And Roscoe's up and about as well. Good on you, Roscoe. Nice to hear from you. Now, there is a bit of a feeling that the outbreak has escaped our clutches in Sydney. 145 new cases, 51 of them infectious while in the community. We're now into week 5 of lockdown, and the numbers are sadly going up. The University of South Australia epidemiologist, Professor Adrian Esterman, says the New South Wales strategy simply is no longer working. The state government is now considering whether to toughen up restrictions in hotspots and ease them in other areas. It's understood the crisis cabinet spoke about easing restrictions in areas like the Northern Beaches, Shell Harbour and the Central Coast. A plan to get students back in classrooms has also been discussed, but nothing yet has been decided. And meanwhile, the problem areas remain the same. Fairfield, Liverpool, Canterbury Bankstown, Blacktown and Cumberland, and we're being told to watch out as cases seep into neighbouring areas too, like Parramatta, Georges River and Bayside. And right now as we go to air, more than 100 residents at a unit block in Blacktown are under lockdown measures after multiple COVID cases were discovered in the building. All residents have been tested overnight. Pathology are on site processing the swabs. And according to James Wilson from Nine News, police will be guarding the building for the next 2 weeks. So that's right now in Blacktown. Then you've got this issue with those aged between 50 and 69. We have just 14.6% of that age group who've had both doses, 55% who've had one dose. The New South Wales Chief Health Officer, Dr. Kerry Chant, says it's distressing to see how few over 60s they've managed to reach. Professor Robert Boy, the infectious diseases expert at the University of Sydney, joins me on the line. Professor, good morning to you.
Good morning, Ben.
What do you make of that number? 14.6% of 50 to 69-year-olds fully vaccinated in New South Wales.
Well, it certainly leaves a lot of room for improvement. But let me tell you this important fact. People in their 50s are at least 50% uptake, and people in their 60s are over 60%. And that's for one dose. And what's crucial about that is that just that one dose in the short term is pretty protective against serious disease, hospitalisation and death. So adding in the second dose does two things. It does increase your protection against infection and catching it and transmitting it, and it also prolongs your infection. So getting as many people getting their first jabs, over 50%, over 60% is good, and then that second jab does the extra little bit, which...
Okay, I mean, let's have a look at that first jab figure for the 50 to 69s, 55% when you average them out. That means 45% are eligible but have decided not to do it.
Well, I don't think they've decided not to. It's an opportunity thing as much. Hesitancy is going out the window. People are really concerned about this virus and they are starting to line up and queue up and get their vaccines. I think the hesitancy rate in that age group is no more than 10 or 15%. It's opportunity. It's getting the chance to go to a GP, go to a pharmacy, go to a hub and get vaccinated. And people are looking much harder. The rate of vaccination has increased markedly. We're up to well over a million doses a week now. And New South Wales is dominating that.
All right, well, that's good to hear. Now, this might give them a little bit of encouragement. Scott Morrison is now talking about vaccine certificates, and they reckon that the states will be able to decide how they're used. So the states will be able to determine when you'll be able to show your vaccine certificate to do certain things. And the flip side of that will be some unvaccinated people may not be able to do certain things. Is that going to give someone some encouragement if they're on the fence?
Yeah, there's lots of incentive. Just getting protected against severe disease is incentive enough. But being able to go to cinemas, to go to restaurants, to go to shopping centres, Italy, France, Germany, lots of countries are already introducing this. They call it a nudge, but really it's a major incentive to not only get vaccinated, but to protect your community, your family, and be able to do all the things that you want to do, get out of lockdown properly.
And when we keep hearing the Prime Minister say, look, if you are younger and you want AstraZeneca, just go and ask your GP. There are a lot of GPs saying no. There are a lot of GPs saying, look, because of the changing advice, we would just prefer to give AstraZeneca to people of a certain age and Pfizer to people of a certain age.
Yeah, well, I talked to four different GPs from around the state only yesterday evening, and they're offering AstraZeneca. Everyone I asked is happy to do it. Myself have had it. I've had it twice, and I'm nearly 60. It's a worthwhile vaccine. It's safe. It's effective. And people are changing their tunes, actually. GPs are indemnified. GPs are paid extra money to spend extra time listening to people's questions, answering people's questions, and then they do recommend Astra in the great majority of cases.
We appreciate your time, as always. Thanks for jumping on the line.
You're welcome.
Professor Robert Boy from the University of Sydney. I spoke to a GP yesterday and said, are you giving out AstraZeneca to people who are younger and people who ask for it? And her answer was, no, not really. No. We're kind of 40 to 60 on Pfizer and then 60 and above on AstraZeneca. And yes, if people ask the questions, of course, we can have a conversation with them about it. But it's just easier for us to run our operation based on if you're this age, this is what you get. And she also made the point, please be conscious of the fact that the person answering the phones at your GP clinic is not deciding the rules of the vaccine rollout, because there have been some very heavy phone calls coming into GP clinics, people angry because they're not getting what they want. It's not the person answering the phone that makes the decisions. Coming up, live to the US and Harley Carnes. First of all, it was Afghanistan. Now the US is pulling out of Iraq. It's a quarter past six. Sydney's weather, 12 degrees at the moment on the coast, 9 in the west. Sunny today, some morning fog, a top of 22.
Sydney's best breakfast. Email Ben now at 2gb.com.
On our way to Harley Carnes at 17 past six, Matt says the partial vaccination rate might be because you've got to wait 12 weeks before your second dose. Well, yes, although that advice has changed as well. Atagi says people in areas where outbreaks are occurring can receive the second dose of AstraZeneca 4 to 8 weeks after the first one, rather than the usual 12. But the other reason is just the chopping and changing of advice. We've had four different lines of advice when it comes to AstraZeneca from the body responsible for giving this advice, the Australian Technical Advisory Group on Immunisation, Atagi. Four changes in 5 months. So, of course, that's going to have a few people thinking, well, how do I know what they're telling me today is going to stack up tomorrow?
You're listening to Sydney's Best Breakfast, Ben Fordham Live. And now, the US report.
First, Afghanistan. Now, the US is pulling combat forces out of Iraq as well. Harley Carnes, good morning.
Good morning, Ben. Yeah, well, the administration wants to be out of there. A lot of Americans want to be out of there. A lot of military people think it's foolhardy. They were only going to turn the countries over to the Taliban and any other radicals that want to do it because a lot of the military people don't think that the governments there are strong enough to be able to hold themselves if they even want to. So we'll see what happens. That's, the die's cast. We'll be out of there shortly, and we'll see how it all works out. We have to, hope and pray that it's going to be better for the people who live there. And so that's the best we can do at the moment.
Harley, it's been a while since I've been on a roller coaster. I don't know about you, but there's a few people in New Mexico who are regretting their ride.
Well, that's for sure. I once said to a girlfriend on the top of a Ferris wheel, wouldn't it be nice if we could get stuck up here for a little while, honey? And she looked at me like, are you nuts? Like, no, it wouldn't be any fun to be up here for a long time. She would have been right. This was a roller coaster and a fast one called El Bandido in New Mexico near the Texas border. Eight teenagers wound up trapped on the top of it. They're lucky it stopped while they were on the top because they're sitting upright. Otherwise, they could have been upside down in some other part of the ride, right? Nowhere to go. Some said they got real hungry. Others said they had to go to the bathroom. Nowhere to go up there. Mm. So I guess it wasn't really all that romantic after all. It used a cherry picker to get them down, big crane. But that's the only thing they could do. We don't even know why it froze so far.
Well, I just want to ask you about this, Harley Carnes, because all of Australia was watching yesterday as the American champion Katie Ledecky lined up for the final of the 400 metres freestyle in Tokyo, but then along came a girl from Australia called Ariane Titmus. Please tell me you were watching in America.
I want to know what made me think you might bring that up. Well, the Terminator lived up to her billing, that's for sure. And I thought it was stunning that halfway through it, she's behind a body length. And Katie Ledecky doesn't lose when she's in that position. But she did because Ms. Titmus ran her down and won just off of Ledecky's world-class, world record pace. So you got to take your hat off to her. I kind of thought the coach went a little nuts, but I can't really blame it.
Yeah. We were loving every second of it. There was an American journalist who wrote before the race, do Katie Ledecky's opponents even think that they have a chance? Well, we know the answer to that.
Really?
Yeah.
That's kind of... Now, don't ever write stuff like that. It's like that's a curse.
Well, we appreciate Harley's Olympic update. Thank you so much for your time.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Good on you. There's Harley Carnes covering the Olympic Games.
An update from Japan. Thanks to the new Kia Cerato GT. Get mean.
Yeah, get mean, all right. Well, yeah, and Dean Boxall, he was all fired up. And I think everyone in Australia loved every minute of it. In other parts of the world, they were thinking, what's this guy's story? And is this really necessary? Well, if you knew what we were going through in Australia at the moment, you would be celebrating every single moment of it. And we will catch up with Dawn Fraser after 8 o'clock this morning. She was celebrating with Ariane Titmus's mum and dad yesterday. Robin and Steve, they must be over the moon. They caught up with Jim Wilson yesterday afternoon on The Drive Show. If you missed that chat, you'll find it up on 2GB.com.
This is Ben Fordham Live with Sydney's Best Breakfast on 2GB 873.
You're listening to Ben Fordham on 2GB. It's 25 minutes past 6. We've got cash code words to give away this morning. The first cash code word, sailor. Sailor is the first cash code word. There's a second one coming. You need both of them if you want to win $1,000. Now, there's a new workplace behaviour program that's being rolled out in Parliament House, Canberra. And this comes in the wake of the Brittany Higgins saga. It aims to overhaul workplace culture in the nation's capital. So for MPs and chiefs of staff, the course will run for 1 hour. It's an online course. For other staff members, it runs for 2, which is interesting. So for MPs and chiefs of staff, you can get the course done in an hour. For others, it takes 2. Government ministers have to complete the course. They've got to do it. For everyone else, technically it's optional, but those who undertake the training will be named on a public register, and therefore, if you haven't done it, your name will be known as well. But technically speaking, you don't have to do it unless you're a minister or you are working for a minister. I think some ministers have said, in my office, this is the rule. You've got to do it. In addition, a new independent complaints team will get to work inside Parliament House. It'll be up and running within 6 weeks. It'll have the power to investigate claims of assault or harassment that happened during the current parliamentary term. Complaints by former staff can also be submitted if the accused still works in Parliament. So that's the latest out of Canberra. They're obviously trying to clean up some of the bad behaviour, but they're also wanting to give a voice to people who feel like they haven't had a voice. So if someone has witnessed bad behaviour, they want a process in place so people can contact someone and something can be done about whoever's done the wrong thing.
Just a little bit of history repeating.
You're listening to Sydney's Best Breakfast, Ben Fordham Live. And now, on this day.
Today is the 27th of July. It's been 25 years since a shocking moment at the Olympic Games when a pipe bomb was detonated during an outdoor concert at the Olympic Park in Atlanta. One person was killed, 111 injured. And it's a fascinating story. The security guard who discovered the bomb, Richard Jewell, was hailed a hero. However, the FBI then pointed the finger at him. He was later cleared, and the real bomber, Eric Rudolph, was given a life sentence in 2005. Look, there is a movie based on the real-life events about that. It's called Richard Jewell, and it's on Netflix. I can recommend it. It's fantastic. Bugs Bunny made his cartoon debut on this day in 1940.
Shh, be very, very quiet. I'm hunting rabbits.
What's up, Doc?
Yeah, Mel.
There's a rabbit down there.
Was the voice of Bugs Bunny for almost 50 years. He was known as the man of a thousand voices. He also played the role of Porky Pig, Daffy Duck, and even Barney Rubble on the Flintstones. And on this day in 1974, Wings were on top of the charts.
And the first one said to the second one there, I hope you're having fun. Band on the run. Band on the run. And the jailer man and sailor Sam were searching everyone for the band on the
run. Yeah, Band on the Run, the top-selling Australian album on this day in 1974, and Wings featured the former Beatle Paul McCartney and his wife Linda. It all happened on this day, July 27. On the text line, someone says, Ben, disgraceful, talking down AstraZeneca, using one case to peddle your childish, bigoted opinion. Sir or madam, I don't know who you're listening to or what radio show, but it ain't this one. Thanks for your correspondence.
Bringing you the best at breakfast. This is Ben Fordham Live on Sydney's 2GB.
131873, the open line number, Ben at 2GB.com if you'd like to send an email. Now, this is encouraging. We're being told we'll have an internationally recognised vaccine passport by October. The PM is in discussions with other world leaders to try and get a system up and running. So Scott Morrison says the pass would be used to facilitate people moving out of the country and into the country. Oh, remember when we went out of the country? Those were the days. Here at home, the PM says this vaccine certificate could be used by the states to decide how much freedom you get. So in the long term, vaccines may end up being the ticket to freedom. But let's be honest, we're probably some time off from cashing in that ticket. We've got 16% of the population fully vaccinated, and we need the majority on board. So that could be the long-term ticket to freedom, and the states would decide where you show that vaccine certificate. So the state of New South Wales, and this is just a hypothetical, they could say, for example, hypothetically speaking, okay, in order to go into a major sporting event, in order to go into a school, in order to go into a concert, you need to show your vaccine certificate after a certain date. They may say that, they may not. The PM's saying it's up to individual states. That's in the long term. But there is a short-term ticket that might buy us back some of our independence, and that is rapid antigen COVID testing. We'll have a look at this at 7:15 this morning. It's not like the ones that we're used to, where you have a swab in the throat and in the nose. Antigen testing is just a pinprick. And instead of waiting 24 to 72 hours, it gives you a result in 15 minutes. And we make them right here in Australia. There's a Brisbane-based company called Alloom, and they're rolling them off the conveyor belt, but then they're shipped off to other parts of the world. Australia's barely using them because rapid antigen testing is not as accurate as traditional tests. Mind you, the Doherty Institute says antigen testing is 99.96% accurate. And it means you get fast results because they have a result within 15 minutes. Yes, of course, 4 out of every 10,000 could return a false result. But if you're testing positive enough, you'll catch any positives that you might have missed. Now, we use them in small pockets, like with some of our Olympic teams. We're about to use them to screen people in Victorian courts. But overseas, they are used widely. 21 countries in the European Union are using them. Germany calls them one of the cornerstones to their coronavirus response. In the UK, everyone has access to 2 free rapid antigen tests every week. In the USA, they've been approved for use by the Food and Drug Administration. So what are we doing here in Australia? It's a local success story, and at the moment, we are not taking full advantage. If we want some short-term freedoms, we need to get behind this Aussie technology.
The Business Report, thanks to La Trobe Financial, Australia's multi-award-winning wealth manager.
Well, this prediction will blow your mind. The NAB reckons Sydney property prices will grow more than 21% this year. Peter Switzer from switzer.com.au. Switz, get out of town.
Yeah, it's staggering, isn't it? And remember, these are like averages. So some suburbs will do better than 21.6% and others will be less. So it's an average number. Interestingly, Ben, 2022, NAB thinks that their rise will only be 3.1%, but I think we can work that one out. If they rise 21.6% this year, next year there's just not going to be enough power left in the market to actually push prices up any higher. But it is staggering given the fact that we've got lockdowns right now. And Alan Oster from NAB says, yeah, the economy will be affected by the lockdown, but then there'll be a big rebound out of the lockdown. So it's quite staggering.
Yeah, people are still snapping up properties, some of them not even visiting those properties face-to-face. Now, you're getting behind a great idea called Adopt-A-Shop. What's it all about?
Yeah, so it was a running wave of Margaret Lomas of destiny.com.au. She's one of the best, ironically, one of the best house price predictors and explainers of investing in property in this country. She was a Telstra Businesswoman of the Year Award winner. Now, she said basically, there are businesses like ours doing well during the COVID situation, but there are a lot in CBDs and local suburbs where businesses are shut down. And she said, well, the businesses are doing really well and might be able to adopt a shop and help them just during lockdown. So, you know, who's it for? It's a business that needs help because of the problems of, you know, the lockdown. What kind of help? Well, a business which is still operating and doing pretty well could adopt a shop just for the period of lockdown and assist them financially. So the examples of kind of help, well, the supporting business might pay the rents and fixed costs, assisting wages while lockdown's on. How does a business select a business? I've actually selected a travel business. I know they're really struggling because travel businesses are. I've decided to help that particular business. But on this website, adoptashop.net, Margaret has listed business A who are prepared to help and B those who need help. So she's basically going to mix them up and match them up. She's also got help from accountants and people like that to make sure the people who apply for help aren't dodgy or anything like that. They actually do need help. How much help? You just decide how much you want to give to that business. And is there any sort of payoff for you for doing it? Well, apart from the feeling of being good, helping somebody else, Margaret thinks that the business that's helped will probably put the logo of the business that's helped them on their website, in the shop. They can promote them. So it'll be a relationship thing. And I just think it's a really, really good idea from a small business in this country.
I'll check it out. Adoptashop.net. Just quickly, the markets?
Yeah, the Dow up 82 points, 35,144. Aussie dollar is 73.9 US cents.
Good on you, mate. We'll catch up soon. There's Peter Switzer from switzer.com.au. It's 16 minutes to 7 o'clock. Coming up, COVID case numbers in the UK fall for the sixth day in a row. We're live to London next. Sydney's weather, 11 degrees on the coast, 8 in Sydney's west. It's sunny today, some morning fog, a top of 22.
This is Sydney's Best Breakfast with Ben Fordham on 2GB.
I mentioned that movie before called Richard Jewell about the bloke who was falsely accused for being responsible for the bombing at the Atlanta Olympics. Ray here from Bondi, as always. He always says, as always, Ray. Ray here from Bondi, as always. That movie, Richard Jewell, is good. No surprise, it was directed by Clint Eastwood. It was too. So no surprise, with Clint Eastwood in the director's chair. Now, I was just talking about rapid antigen testing. We're going to have a closer look at that at 7.15 this morning. Wendy, you've got another example to add to the list. Good morning.
Good morning, Ben. Yes, I do. I'm delighted that you're going to be talking about this. A friend of mine, he's Greek, lives in Athens, called me and was telling me that in Greece, every school child is issued with three free rapid test kits per week. They pick it up from the pharmacy. The kid is test themselves, obviously, on a Monday morning. If it's negative, they can go to school. Now, if Greece is doing this, why the hell are we not? Just imagine the Year 12 kids. Mm. They could go to school if we use this.
Yeah, well,
I don't understand why we're
so far behind. Yeah, you're spot on. It's not just Greece. 21 countries in the EU. Germany says it's one of the cornerstones of our response. In the UK, everyone has two free rapid antigen tests per week. They're 99.96% accurate. So we should be rolling them out widely here in Australia.
You're listening to Sydney's Best Breakfast, Ben Fordham Live. And now, the UK Report.
Well, John Adderley filling in for Adam Gilchrist at the moment. And John, this is good news again. Case numbers in the UK have come down for a sixth day in a row. How's freedom looking?
Yeah. How's freedom? Well, it feels good looking at these figures. Actually, it's got the scientists scratching their heads a little bit because we don't want to knock it, do we? But they find this is all a little bit unexpected, although, of course, it's good news. I mean, it might be a blip, but it looks pretty clear, doesn't it?
You think it's too good to be true, don't you?
Well, I think that is possibly right, partly because, you know, we haven't felt the impact yet of easing restrictions in England, which was only a week ago. So, you know, that is still a little way down the track. So that could change things. But, hey, let's go with it, shall we? Just under 25,000 daily cases in the latest daily figures, down from nearly 47,000 a week ago. And certainly it looks like we can put in the bin these fears of 100,000 cases a day. So that's certainly a good thing. And this is an interesting thought as well. It is the first time since the start of the pandemic that we've had a continuing drop in cases that doesn't coincide with a national lockdown. So, yeah, it is looking good. But, of course, that's when Downing Street and the government get all uppity and say, don't get carried away, folks. We're not out of the woods yet. Don't let your guard down. But, yeah, it's encouraging news. Cases down, running.
And as far as deaths are concerned, 14 deaths from COVID overnight. Now, when you compare that to up above 1,000 a day back in January, that is certainly good news. And a lot of the world is watching because, obviously, Boris Johnson is having a crack here at learning to live with the virus. Now, you've got a new deal with France to stop terror attacks in the English Channel.
Yeah, I mean, this is intriguing. I didn't realise there was such a great threat, but apparently so. Terror attacks on cross-channel ferries and other ships crossing the channel. Well, to deal with this, they've signed in Paris today what they're calling the UK-France Maritime Security Treaty to swiftly and effectively deal with threats. Now, there are some suspicions that is this really more to do with an agreement on how to deal with the other problem in the channel, which these dangerously overloaded small boats carrying illegal migrants? Is it something to do with that? But no, they're stressing this is all about sharing information about security threats, and the two foreign secretaries and the two defence secretaries from France and the UK met to discuss this and various other things. Who knew that we had so many shared interests? They discussed European security, security in Africa, joint working on China, Russia, Iran, Afghanistan, and the Indo-Pacific. Seems from that that the Entente Cordiale is very much up and running and in very good shape.
Yeah, sometimes we fall into the trap of thinking that COVID is the only threat out there. We will talk tomorrow. You go and enjoy some more freedom.
Thanks very much, Ben.
Good on you. John Adderley filling in for Adam Gilchrist at the moment. It's 10 to 7. Back home, the ABC has been on a spending spree. Not on children's TV shows or a 15th jazz channel, but on legal bills. The ABC has racked up a staggering $26 million on legal bills in just the past 4 years. $26.3 million in 4 years. Last year was a busy year. They spent more than $7 million on various legal claims. $2.6 million was spent fighting defamation action from Christian Porter and Peter Volandis. According to the ABC's annual report, some of which has been published in the Daily Telegraph, the legal department handled 100 different defamation complaints in 2020 alone. They must have some money to burn. The ABC's budget last financial year was $880 million, but they're crying poor. They want another $90 million in funding over the next 3 years. Well, the lawyers must be loving it. They've pocketed $26 million of taxpayers' money in the last 4 years alone.
Sydney's best breakfast. Email Ben now at 2gb.com.
Thank you for being with us. It's 5 to 7. Another three athletes have tested positive to COVID-19 in the Olympic Village. That takes the total to 16, including all team officials, volunteers and workers. 148 people connected to the Games have come down with the virus in Tokyo. The IOC is again urging athletes to keep their masks on at all times, but admits that is difficult to enforce. The IOC says masks can be removed, but only for a short period of time on the podium.
An update from Japan, thanks to the new Kia Cerato GT. Get mean.
Yeah, I want to give a wrap to the Australian surfer Owen Wright. He's still going in the men's competition after winning his third round event with a massive score of 15. The fact that he's even surfing is amazing, this guy. In 2015, he was surfing in Hawaii when he was caught under a massive 15-foot wave. He suffered a traumatic brain injury, Owen Wright, and he had to learn how to walk again. He took a year off the tour, returned in 2017, and this is an amazing comeback. He's only 31, and he's part of a famous surfing family from the south coast of New South Wales. His sister, Tyler Wright, is a two-time world champion. His brother, Mikey, is also on the pro tour. So he's in the quarterfinals, Owen Wright, this morning after 8 a.m. And then you've also got Stephanie Gilmore, who was knocked out in the third round. Julian Wilson also lost. But Sally Fitzgibbons from the Illawarra is still alive after a big win. In the team sports, Mexico beat Australia 4-1 in the softball. Our women's hockey team is undefeated, beating China 6-0. A mixed day for the men's rugby sevens. We lost to Argentina 29-19, but then we thumped South Korea 42-5. Our women's water polo team beat the Netherlands 15-12. Ash Barty is still alive in the women's tennis doubles with her partner Storm Sanders. So that's the latest from Tokyo. And after 8 o'clock this morning, we're going to catch up with the one and only Dawn Fraser, who was with the mum and dad of Ariane Titmus yesterday when she knocked off the best in the world, Katie Ledecky.
A sports update brought to you by Didi's Waterfront Group. Book now at didisgroup.com.au.
James Willis is with us. James, one of the NRL's most loved players, has played his last game.
Yeah, this is a bit disappointing, Ben. Roger Tuivasa-Sheck, who's been a fan favourite for a long period of time, Dally M medalist, champion fullback, very modest and a great leader with the Warriors, has been given an immediate release. He's going to leave the club on Thursday. He says he misses New Zealand, wants to see his family. Now, we know the Warriors have been away from home, living on the Central Coast for the last 18 months, but it's a huge blow for the rest of their season. If they weren't gone already, they are now. We probably won't see him again in rugby league because he's switching codes to play for the All Blacks from next year.
Good luck to him. Ariane Titmus yesterday, it was just fantastic. And the coach kind of stole the limelight in a way, Dean Boxall. He just couldn't believe it.
Yeah, and I think this bloke is the best swimming coach in Australia. He flogs his athletes and he gets the best out of them. He wants to ride the emotion with them. Titmus, phenomenal swim, knocking off a previous Olympic undefeated athlete in Katie Ledecky, the American. And the other big performance yesterday, Kyle Chalmers, who was fifth on the final turn in the 100 relay, hit a 46.44 for his split. Now, if he does that, it'll be a world record in the 100 metres. Watch him. He's a big chance of gold.
Thank you, mate.
Thank you, mate.
At 7.45, the Federal Environment Minister is going to be joining us, Susan Lee, to talk about the Great Barrier Reef.
Now on 2GB, Ben Fordham Live, Sydney's best breakfast.
Good morning. We've got $1,000 up for grabs on the show this morning. You need two cash code words. I've already given away the first one. You need to tune in early to listen and make sure you write it down. The second one, Zipper. Z-I-P-P-E-R. Zipper is the second cash code word for this morning. Ian says, morning, Ben. Just to let you know, there were two earthquakes felt in the Wallandilly area, 10:30 p.m. and 11:30 p.m. It was big enough for the house to feel like it shook. Well, you're right, Ian. I'm just having a look here at Geoscience Australia. They measured a 2.8 magnitude earthquake around Picton, New South Wales. So, yes, you felt it right.
And now, Ben Fordham comments. Thanks to West End Mazda, North Parramatta and Blacktown. Open 7 days for your new Mazda test drive.
Well, sometimes in sport, the result only tells you part of the story. And that is the case with our new gold medalist, Ariane Titmus. She won the 400-metre freestyle, beating the greatest female swimmer ever, the American Katie Ledecky. But let me tell you the story of how this came about, because this is about a girl living out a lifetime dream, and it wasn't just her. It was the whole family involved and her coach. A family who made enormous sacrifices because Ariane Titmus was born in Tasmania and her potential was noticed early on in the early teen years of her life. So 6 years ago, her parents made a big, big call. They packed up the entire family and moved from Tassie to Brisbane. Mum and Dad, Steve and Robin, wanted to give their daughter the best chance of becoming a champion. So they enrolled her with Dean Boxall, who is a superstar coach. He's known for being pretty tough, take no prisoners. He flogs swimmers, but in his words, he bleeds with them. And when Ariane joined Dean Boxall in 2015, she was swimming the 400 metres freestyle in 4 minutes 12. Katie Ledecky then won gold in Rio in a new world record. It was 16 seconds faster than Ariane's best. So just imagine that. 16 seconds she had to make up. Boxall says, we just started chipping away. He put her through an intense military training regime, including a period he calls Hell Month. Sounds like fun, right? 7 hours of training every day for 4 weeks. Hell, all right. Boxall says it's all about finding the inner animal. And when you have a look at Dean Boxall, you've got a feeling that he's got plenty of animal. He was mic'd up in the lead up to Tokyo. Just have a listen to how he interacts with his squad.
One more week, we fly to Tokyo. We're going to the enemy's land, mate. They're all going to be there. You're going to walk on the pool deck and see your competitors, Ian, ask, who did the better job? What an honour to be on the pursuit of going to the Olympics and being number one. Oh.
What about when he says, we're going to enemy land. We're going to Tokyo in 1 week. Look, a lot of people couldn't handle it, but Ariane knew Dean was trying to help her. He wanted to get the best out of her. So then we get to the Olympics. Titmus is in form, but the American Katie Ledecky is still considered the best female swimmer of all time. She's never lost at the Olympics. She's won 5 gold medals. The American has 15 world championship titles and 3 current world records. In the lead-up to the race, one US journalist wrote, do Katie Ledecky's opponents even think they have a chance? Well, yes. Ariane Titmus believed she did. Dean Boxall thought so. So did Steve and Robin Titmus. Then comes the 400-metre final yesterday. Katie Ledecky was in control for almost all of the race, but with 100 to go, Ariane Titmus drew level. And then she found another gear. She hit the lead, and she didn't look back. Ian Thorpe was urging her on in commentary, but so were 25 million Australians back home doing exactly the same. Mum and Dad, Steve and Robin, were screaming at the TV in Queensland. Robin says, "My God, she can race." And she did. She hit the wall 0.67 of a second in front of the greatest ever. As Basil Zemplis said in commentary, to become a legend, you've got to beat a legend. And she did. Her time, 16 seconds faster than when she started with Dean Boxall. And how much did we all need that? Boxall has now gone viral for his reaction. He went berserk. He says, "When I go home, I dream for my swimmers. I don't turn off. That's why I get emotional." And after the win, Ariane Titmus said, "I was just a little girl who started swimming, who had a big dream. I tried to think about that this morning when I woke up. And I think about everyone back home doing it tough in lockdown. I feel nice that I can put on a bit of a show and bring back a bit of joy to everyone's lounge rooms." Well, Ariane Titmus, you did that. And here's the best part. That was the first installment in a trilogy. We've got the 200 and the 800 freestyle to come. Titmus leads Ledecky 1-0. Bring it on. How good was it yesterday? And if you haven't had the chance to show it to your children, if you've got youngsters like I do, take the time to show them the replay and point out the American, Katie Ledecky in the black cap, explain she's the best in the world, no one can beat her, and then just watch that Aussie in the gold cap and watch the reactions when you show them the video. Now, we do need to let you know that there are concerns for anyone who visited the Campsie Centre shopping mall any time between July 14 and July 24. The centre has been visited by a confirmed case. Transmission's already been detected. If you were there on those dates, you must get tested and isolate for 14 days regardless of the result. That's for the Campsie Centre shopping mall any time between July 14 and July 24. You're listening to Ben Fordham on 2GB. In a moment, why we need rapid antigen testing down under.
This is Ben Fordham Live with Sydney's Best Breakfast on 2GB 873.
16 minutes after 7 o'clock, you're with Ben Fordham on 2GB. Now, I want to hear from Year 12 parents this morning and Year 12 students. Any students doing their final exams, how are you getting on at the moment? Trials have started in some schools this week, despite no one being in class. Hundreds of schools have delayed the trials by 2 weeks. And then you've got practical exams, things like drama, music, dancing and design, technology. Now, I just want to fact check something that Gladys Berejiklian told me yesterday. She says, "We have allowed students with practical exams to actually come onto the school campus. If there are practical requirements for kids to be at school, there are provisions for that already. If they need face-to-face learning." Well, there's not a lot of face-to-face learning going on, but are you getting access to school if you need to for practical exams? Is that happening? Are you getting the support you need? Because the Herald is reporting this morning that this may not be happening as much as the Premier is asking. Singers and musicians can't rehearse at school due to COVID risk. Schools have been told to allow HSC students when absolutely necessary, but that's the reason why we've got indecision and uncertainty, because of words like that. Schools have been told to allow HSC students when absolutely necessary. In other words, if it's not absolutely necessary, then don't have the kids at school. I mean, they're getting ready for their HSC trials. If you're having trouble, let us know. We will raise it with the education department. And I think this is a bit heavy-handed. The head of the Sydney Catholic Schools is calling for the HSC exams to be cancelled altogether. Greg Whitby says because of indefinite online learning, the exam should be replaced with assessments. But people have spent a year or more preparing for major exams. And now you've got people like the head of Sydney Catholic Schools essentially waving the white flag. The Treasurer Dominic Perrottet and the Deputy Premier John Barilaro are pushing to get Year 12 students back straight away. In my opinion, they should have been back yesterday.
Sydney's best breakfast. 2GB.
19 minutes after 7 o'clock. Now, we need to approve rapid antigen COVID testing in Australia because in outbreaks, it can take 3, 4, or 5 days to get a result in a traditional test. Rapid antigen testing gives you a result in just 15 minutes. You can take the test at home. We make them here in Australia. The Brisbane company Allume has just signed a $300 million deal with the US Defence Department. Another Aussie company is entering the Asian market, but our own Therapeutic Goods Administration has not approved the tests for use here. Let's go to Robbie Catter from Catter's Australian Party. Robbie Catter, good morning to you.
Hi, good morning, Ben.
You've been giving this a big push. Tell me why it's important that we hurry up and hit go.
Well, I mean, for a start, we should be doing everything possible to get business back on the ground and get us back to normality. And all these other countries around the world have adopted the same practice. And there might be a good reason for it, Ben, but I don't know what that is. And, the second reason is it's Australian-developed technology and an Australian business. And, we've essentially helped that R&D for that that resource, and it's been benefited from all the other countries and not us. So, we should be, for a start, backing our own guys and our own businesses, and also we want to be back on the ground as soon as possible, and this stuff can get us answers straight away. So it would be a really effective way of getting us as close to back to normality as possible.
According to the Doherty Institute, the rapid antigen testing is 99.96% accurate. You've got 21 countries in the EU using them, including Greece, which is distributing testing kits to school students and staff. In Singapore, people are screened before going to sporting events and entertainment venues using these rapid antigen tests. In Germany, you've got to have a negative rapid test in the last 24 hours if you want to take part in indoor social activity. I mean, we talk about vaccines being part of the passport to freedom, but that's in the long term. This is the short term. We need to do something about this, Robbie.
Well, that's the question in our mind, because, everyone in the whole thing's been focused on the, lockdown, keep us safe and that sort of thing. But, there's all those, hundreds of thousands of small business out there that are saying, when can we start operating again? And this is the key to getting back faster into normality. And when that answer's lying there, the question needs to be asked. And if there's a really good reason, fine. But we need some answers from government why we're not implementing this right now, so that we can have that rapid testing in place.
All right. Well, good on you for lobbying the TGA, and we'll keep up the fight here. Robbie, nice to talk to you.
Thanks, Ben. All the best.
Robbie Catter from Catter's Australian Party. Now, in the US, modelling from Harvard says rapid testing will save their economy more than $25 billion US dollars a year. Greg says, my daughter's in the UK working as a nanny. The kids she looks after had a rapid test. Both showed positive. She got tested, and yes, she was positive too. She's okay now, but absolutely we should be using them here. Raj says rapid antigen testing has been available in India for several months. Anyone can buy it for 250 rupees, or about $5. Diana says if we screened healthcare workers, such as ED, COVID wards, aged care, etc., we would reduce the risk of them infecting patients and other staff. Why aren't we doing it here? It doesn't make sense.
This is Sydney's Best Breakfast with Ben Fordham on 2GB.
26 after 7, the second code word for cash code words, zipper. Z-I-P-P-E-R is the second code word, zipper. Anthony's just called in. Now, Anthony, you want to talk about HSC. Good morning to you.
Yes, good morning, Ben. How are you?
Good. Are you calling from a school as such?
I am. I'm a principal at St. Leo's Catholic College at Roonga, and we're a year 7 to 10, 7 to 12 school, sorry.
Okay. And what's going on with the HSE?
Good question. After reading the remedial reports this morning, I believe the students need some clarity, definite clarity, about what's happening both with the HSC and also with the upcoming trials. And I know there's lots of talk about it, but I'm having a Zoom meeting tonight with the Year 12 students and an invitation to all parents tomorrow night, just so I can give certainly my perspectives and about what's going on and trying to give some clarity because that's so important. But our students have been up for their practical trial preparations and their practical HSC preparations with music, industrial technology, wood, drama, and all those subjects that have the practical element to them.
And what about the HSC trials? Have you delayed yours?
Yes, we have. Yeah, most Catholic schools who are using the Catholic school trials have delayed theirs, and it's supposed to start on August the 9th. But, that'd be interesting to see whether it does start then.
And what about the head of Sydney Catholic Schools, Greg Whitby, saying we should just cancel the HSC altogether?
Greg Whitby he runs the Parramatta Diocesan Catholic Schools, and Tony Farley runs the Sydney Catholic Schools. And there's merits on both sides of that argument. Certainly, it's a far bigger debate than what we can do over the next couple of days. That's for sure.
Okay, but most of your students aren't able to do any face-to-face learning at the moment in the lead up to their trials.
The school's open. I'm up here at school at the moment, and we have about 1 to 2% of students coming a day, and we have they come to school. They're supervised here at school, but they don't actually have face-to-face. They operate via Zoom and the home-based learning program that we do have.
Boy, it's tough for them at the moment.
It is. It's very tough. Yeah, that's why we just need some clarity and some certainty. So as soon as the government can get round to that, that'd be fantastic.
And I'm sure you've read all the expert medical advice that says that kids should be back at school.
Yeah, but then we've also got the teachers here as well, so they're not quite in the same boat. So we've got to balance both, and it's difficult, absolutely difficult. And I also feel for the parents. You know, I speak to a lot of parents, not a lot of parents, but certainly a few parents every night, and, you know, some of them are finding it very, very tough running their own jobs at home and also trying to supervise the students, particularly those with younger students.
No doubt about it. You're a good man for calling in, and I wish your students the best of luck with the HSC trials. Anthony, thank you very much.
Very much, Ben. Good on you.
Good on you. Anthony's the principal at St Leo's School in Warunga. I'd love to hear from other principals out there, other teachers, other parents, other students. 131873.
People you know. Opinions that matter. News you can trust. This is Breakfast with Ben Fordham on Sydney's 2GB.
131873, the open line number. You can use the text line 0460 873 873. Just on the rapid antigen testing and the question mark over why we're not using it more widely here in Australia, Lynn says, two of my children went to the semi-finals at Wimbledon. Everyone had this rapid test. They waited 15 minutes, then they were allowed in. Jane says all staff at Homebush Vaccination Centre use the rapid result testing before they start their shift every day, and they have a full test once a week. Well, we're following up on that one with New South Wales Health. Just on getting the jab, by the way, I've got my second jab in the arm now yesterday afternoon, so I'm fully vaxxed. I do admit that I did have a little bit of a restless night's sleep, but I didn't have a headache or anything like that that required a Panadol. Noel's got the right message. He says, my wife and I are in our 70s. We've both had our AstraZeneca jabs. Nil effects. Wake up, people. Do it for yourself, your family, your mates and Australia. The country I served and whose freedoms me and my mates served and we suffered and died for. He says, get off your selfish backsides and think of your fellow Aussies. And here's another one from Don. Morning, Ben. I've had my two AstraZeneca jabs and now I feel comfortable going out shopping with a low risk of infection. But I should now be rewarded with some freedom. If this was allowed, it's a good incentive for promoting the jab. I'm over 60, retired, and a little bit bored at home. Just a little bit, eh, Don? Yeah, it's like that, isn't it? Where you think, all right, what are we going to do now? We'll go for a walk? We go for another walk, and I know that there's a couple who live across the road from us, Nikki and Ed, and they've got a beautiful little dog called Banjo, and Banjo's sick of all the walks, because previously Banjo would go for 2 walks a day, now Banjo's going for about 6 walks a day, and Banjo's run off his feet. Now, when we're talking about giving people a little bit of hope through rapid antigen testing or going and getting the jab, there is another idea that's being floated here, and this is something that will be discussed in the National Cabinet and also the New South Wales Cabinet. It's obviously a New South Wales decision to make, but it's all around whether or not we can give some freedoms to some areas where we don't have many cases popping up. Now, the Premier talks about green shoots and where she sees them growing. Gladys Berejiklian said to us yesterday, the green shoots are the fact that we've been able to contain the virus to parts of Sydney. So she's talking about Sydney Southwest. Places like Fairfield, Liverpool, Canterbury, Bankstown, they have higher case numbers. But others don't. And at some point, you're going to have to relax some restrictions in those other areas. There are entire suburbs that have been locked in their home for a month despite having virtually zero COVID cases and zero exposure sites. So I want to hear from people this morning in lower parts of the Central Coast, from Broken Bay to Terrigal to Gosford and the Glenworth Valley. How do you feel being locked up with not a single active COVID case in your area? It's not about historical ones or how many there used to be. It's about here and now. There are suburbs that currently have zero active cases, but they're still in lockdown. Orchard Hills, Glenmore Park, and Blaxland. Zero, zero, zero. Balgowlla, Mossman, Manly, Cremorne. Zero. Alexandria, Zetland in the inner city. Zero. Cherrybrook, Turramurra, Beecroft, and Pennant Hills in the northwest. Zero, 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 zero. And then in the inner west, Lewisham, Petersham, Stanmore, Haberfield. And then you've got places like Newcastle, zero cases. The Blue Mountains, zero active cases. If you're living in any of these areas, how is the lockdown affecting you? I know children are climbing walls, businesses are going under, the mental toll is enormous. And in the areas I've just mentioned, there's no virus to be seen. Now, nobody wants to see Sydney Southwest placed under even tighter rules. They're paying the price for the government's failure to lock down the eastern suburbs. But we can't argue with the scoreboard. So we may need to take harsher action where the numbers are climbing and give people a break in other parts of the city and the state where the virus is not present. 131873, the open line number. Ben@2gb.com if you'd like to send an email. Ryan says, Ben, did you have AstraZeneca or Pfizer? I had Pfizer, Ryan. The moment they said anyone over 40 is eligible for the vaccine, you can go and have Pfizer. I signed up then, so I was in a long queue. And even though I was being sent some of these links that say, oh, there's a bit of a shortcut through other areas, and I've since learned that those links are entirely legitimate to use, but I was a little bit paranoid at the time. I thought, no, I better wait in queue like everyone else. So I was waiting and waiting and waiting for my appointment to pop up at the vaccine hub. But then with Jody's dad going into palliative care and our local GP getting their first lot of Pfizer, the local GP said to me, if you're going in to visit your father-in-law every couple of days in a palliative care unit, you should be vaccinated. You should be vaccinated now. And obviously with Pfizer, you've got the 3-week turnaround. So I got the first one 3 weeks ago, had the second one yesterday. 131873, the open line number.
This is Ben Fordham Live with Sydney's Best Breakfast on 2GB 873.
On the text line, someone says, hi Ben, if they open up suburbs with zero cases, it will promote movement, which is what the Premier is trying to avoid. Well, that's where they need to come up with a set of rules, because if you've got places that don't have any cases, you can't have people from other areas where there are cases going into those places where there are not. Now, speaking of areas where they don't have COVID present at the moment, the Blue Mountains. Adam's on the line. Hello, Adam.
G'day, Ben. Thanks, mate. Just want to put an idea out there. What about locking down LGAs and opening up LGAs so people can move within them? I think that's going to be a really good idea for the Premier in the next few days. That should be able to get some movement back into LGAs where there is no COVID cases, so people can have just a little bit of normality back. That'd be awesome.
Well, I'm sure that you would welcome that in the Blue Mountains. Let's go to the Central Coast. Hello, Gary.
Hey, Ben. Our frustration, yeah, I've got a small business, but the Central Coast is locked down. We've had no cases till suddenly one this week. But half an hour up the road towards Newcastle is open. So you have neighbours technically that can't visit each other, but it's driving us mad. No one's helping us, and it's just frustrating as hell.
Well, we know how hard it is to be in lockdown. So my theory is you're better off resting people when they're on the reserves bench instead of having them doing chin-ups and hill sprints, and then they're wrecked by the time they actually do have a case in their area. You need to give them some liberties and then have them fresh and ready to go in case they do need to go into lockdown.
This is Ben Fordham Live with Sydney's Best Breakfast on 2GB 873.
Well, we need to say congratulations to Susan Lee, the Federal Environment Minister, because the Great Barrier Reef is safe for now. It's still in the sights of the UN's environmental body, UNESCO. Until last week, the committee was ready to downgrade the Great Barrier Reef and make it in danger. And then Susan Lee went on a bit of a worldwide adventure to try and turn the vote around, and she had a win. Susan Lee, good morning to you.
Good morning, Ben, and good morning to your listeners.
Congratulations. I know you put in a lot of hard work, but this was the right decision, wasn't it?
Well, Team Australia put in a lot of hard work, Ben, and that was across many government departments, and certainly spending a week where I visited personally some of the countries that were on, that are on the World Heritage Committee, I think made a difference, because an in danger listing would have been a real kick in the teeth to our tourism operators who work so hard, our farmers, our fishers, our marine park managers. And people overseas didn't necessarily understand this is 2,300 kilometres of coastline with $3 billion of investment. And, you know, farmers have to watch what they do on their farm so that the water quality going into the inshore reef is good. Fishers have to report back. Marine park managers make sure they kick out anyone who shouldn't be there. And this is just a massive community effort. And just explaining that to people, plus, of course, the reason for the in danger listing was a climate change related one. And how can Australia control the emissions of the whole world? We're part of it, but we're not all of it.
Let's be fair dinkum here, Minister. This was a job from China to try and jam Australia. The bloke running the last meeting is a minister in the Chinese government, and Beijing put pressure on a number of other committee members to try and downgrade the Great Barrier Reef. So it was a political move. It was payback from China.
Look, all I can report is what I saw in the meeting, and actually, the Chinese delegate went along with a consensus, the overwhelming consensus, which came from 19 out of 21 countries who basically agreed with us that it made no sense to be on the in danger list. So there was a fair bit of, green bureaucracy politics, if I can call them that, which you often do find in some of these bodies, particularly when they're centred on a big picture without understanding individual countries as well as they should understand Australia. Just to have that climate change message mentioned as many times as it was gave me the opportunity to come back and say, hang on a minute, do you realise that our emissions are lower than the OECD average? Do you realise that we've got international partnerships in technology with Singapore, Germany and Japan that are all about how we bring emissions down? And, you know, do you realise that we're 1.3% only of global emissions? So making those points is really important.
I know you've had a lot on your plate with the Great Barrier Reef, but I've got a question for you as a former health minister, and that is whether we should be having a look at this rapid antigen COVID testing in Australia that gives you a result in 15 minutes. You've got 21 countries in the EU using them. Germany says they're a cornerstone for their coronavirus response. In the UK, everyone's got access to two free rapid antigen tests per week. They're being used in the USA, but we're not really using them in Australia. Should they be part of our response?
Well, as I understand through the Health Minister, we've approved some 18 through the TGA. So I hope the states pick this up. I hope the public health authorities use them. Obviously, in the middle of a pandemic where it's sad and it's frightening, you've got to be careful too with home diagnosis. But the chief health officers in each state are vital to this, and I'd like to see them deliver a positive message. So I think they're on their way well and truly, and I think they are an important part of our response.
Congratulations again on your whirlwind adventure, all about saving the reputation of the reef, and we hope we can all get there sometime soon. Thanks for joining us.
Cheers. Thanks, Ben.
Susan Lee, the Federal Environment Minister. It's 9 to 8. On the text line, Meredith says, Ben, what about Mona Vale, Newport, Avalon? No cases, and it's our third lockdown. What about us? And plenty of other people asking the same question. Well, that is going to form part of the conversation in the so-called crisis cabinet, as Gladys Berejiklian, Dominic Perrottet, Brad Hazzard, John Barilaro, and others try and work out, should we lift restrictions in some areas while tightening the grip in others.
This is Ben Fordham Live with Sydney's best breakfast on 2GB.
It's 7:55. If it's time for a new shower screen, then it's time to check out Palmer's Glass, palmersglass.com.au. Now, Andy's got a bit of a warning for anyone on the Anzac Parade. Andy, what's happening right now, mate?
Oh, morning, Ben. Yeah, it was just a few minutes ago. It's in Kingsford, where the old roundabout used to be, on Anzac and Gardeners. There was all several ambulances. There was the ambulance supervisor. There was general duties, highway patrol. All of a sudden, they lit up all their sirens. It was like a chase. Even the ambulances were all doing U-turns in front of us and heading to somewhere. Then the police, highway patrol and general duties were heading. So they're heading towards, like, Daceyville, but looked like something happening. It was a chase or something, but the ambulance were involved. And so it was all around that area, just, you know, okay, where the old Kingsford roundabout
used
to be.
Not every day that you see that, particularly Ambo's involved. So, look, we'll make a few phone calls and see if we can find out what's going on. Good on you, Andy. Thank you very much for letting us know. And a reminder, well, we share with our listeners a Uniden product, a security camera to go outside your front door at the end of every week for whoever gives us the best news tip. So if you spot something, make sure you let us know. Now, there's all sorts of excuses for those who attended the illegal protest on Saturday. Some of them claim that they didn't know it was authorised, or they thought it was authorised when in fact it was unauthorised. But my favourite excuse comes from an eastern suburbs landscaper who went to the so-called Freedom Rally. His name is Alan Omer. He says he was trying to save the life of a rainbow lorikeet. His lawyer says he saw a rainbow lorikeet being trampled on the ground and made his way over to a tree to protect it. Police saw him helping the bird. He then continued to join the group and heard over a bullhorn a general move on direction. He's been convicted and fined $660 for disobeying public health orders and police orders. And outside of court, the birdman did admit he attended the protest to defend his democratic right to freedom. The 52-year-old says he wasn't involved in any of the violence. And there's no word on what's happened to the rainbow lorikeets.
A sports update thanks to the Kia Sorento, boasting class-leading safety, first-in-class tech, and now winner of Car Sales Car of the Year. Go to kia.com.au.
James Willis is here and he's glued to the TV screen at the moment, as we all are with the Olympic Games going on. James, we've had a great day of activity yesterday. What can we look forward to today?
Well, it's really heading up, Ben. Swimming finals again this morning from 11:30. Ariane Titmus in action in the semis of the 200. She won't meet Katie Ledecky until the final of that event. That'll be the sequel of their clash in the 400 won by Titmus. We're a big chance of gold this morning. The world record holder Kaylee McEwen, the 20-year-old from Queensland, is in the 100 backstroke final. So is Emily Seabomb. Mitch Larkin in the men's event. He's another one coached by Dean Boxall. And the team sports, worth watching this morning, a massive game for our men's rugby seven. They take on New Zealand at 11:30 a.m. We've got to win that. We haven't beat New Zealand in that event for 3 years. Matildas, huge game tonight. They take on the United States at 6 o'clock, an important win there. And look, away from all of that, if you want to watch the best athlete at these games, the American gymnast Simone Biles is in action in the women's team event, 8:45 tonight. Give her a watch. It is magic.
Yeah, she is magic. I'll tell you who else I love, that Jian Fang Lei, the mum from Melbourne, who's in her, I think, her sixth Olympic Games in table tennis.
Almost
a record.
And she
just loves it. She doesn't muck around.
Look, and you wonder when you watch the table tennis, how many points do you reckon you could win if you're taking on one of those top players?
None.
Oh, you'd win a serve, wouldn't you? Maybe beer pong.
Thank you very much. Thank you, mate. James Willis there. News is next at 8.
This is Sydney's Best Breakfast with Ben Fordham on 2GB.
Coming up, Dawn Fraser on the incredible Ariane Titmus. And we got a call from Andy a few minutes ago who saw a lot of police and ambos driving along Anzac Parade. Well, police have now told us they have arrested two men after a foot pursuit on Bunurong Road in Kingsford. A third man is on the run and the dog squad is after him.
People you know. know. Opinions that matter. News you can trust. You're listening to the best at breakfast. And now, Ben Fordham comments.
Well, we receive all sorts of feedback around here. As you'd expect, it's part of the job. And yesterday, someone complained that I described the month-long Great Sydney never-ending lockdown as ridiculous. Apparently, that kind of language is unhelpful at a time like this, and it just whips people up. Well, my experience is people don't need any whipping up at the moment. They're already angry and anxious, and they don't need a bloke sitting behind a microphone saying, everything's just fine, when hundreds of thousands of people don't have a job to go to. My main message has been, this must be our last lockdown, because we can't keep going on like this. And if I use the word ridiculous, well, that wouldn't surprise me. I think it's ridiculous that we're in this situation heading into the fifth week of lockdown. I think it's ridiculous that we didn't lock down the eastern suburbs when all of this kicked off. I think it's ridiculous that the limo driver was able to transport airline crew without a mask and without being vaccinated. So I'm not all that surprised if I've been throwing around the word ridiculous. I've certainly described the lockdowns as destructive and depressing and damaging to our health because they're terrible. They're terrible for children, awful for older people. And I think everyone wants to know, when are we going to get out of this thing? And while the health impacts of COVID are deadly serious, so are the health impacts of lockdowns. Just ask anyone at Lifeline or the Kids Helpline. They're the ones taking the calls. Or the funeral director who told us last week he's seeing a spike in suicides. We got an email from a tradie who spoke about wanting to harm himself with his nail gun. We spoke to a mother who drives to her son's house every morning to make sure that he's still with us. He was running his own business, employing six people, and thanks to COVID, it all vanished. Lockdowns are destructive on our health. And if you're going to lock people in their homes for 1 month, 2 months, or maybe 3 months or more, we've got a right to question the game plan. And the current game plan has had holes in it since the very start. And for a few weeks now, I've been asking a pretty straightforward question. Can we really achieve our goal? Because we've been told we won't be out of lockdown until we can get the number of people infectious while in the community down to zero. Now, I've cast doubt on that from the beginning. Because the people who are infectious in the community don't know they're infectious in the community. So how do you stop people from doing something that they don't know they're doing? We've spoken to an epidemiologist from Harvard Medical School, Martin Kulldorff, who says you're never going to get it down to zero. So it's not just me saying we need to be realistic and we need to accept that coronavirus isn't going anywhere. So yes, I do question parts of the lockdown strategy. I make no apologies for thinking some decisions have been ridiculous. I think it's ridiculous that Year 12 kids are being kept away from face-to-face learning in the lead-up to the HSC trials. They should be there yesterday. I think it's ridiculous that schools have blocked kids from going when overwhelmingly the experts say it's in their best interest to be there. It's ridiculous that our education officials are now waving the white flag on the rest of this school term. I think it's ridiculous that 300,000 tradies and construction workers were stood down when there was no specific health advice informing that decision. And yes, it was ridiculous that the health minister advised against that when we're told every other time it's all about the health advice. It's ridiculous that elderly people can't have a lawnmower man come around and cut the grass when there's no face-to-face contact. It's ridiculous that the Premier yesterday justified that decision saying, oh yeah, but the lawnmower man might stop to get petrol. Like, it's only cars driven by gardeners that require fuel. I think it's ridiculous that businesses have had to wait until week 5 of the lockdown to register for payroll support. And the fact they've now got to wait a few more weeks for the money to hit their accounts. I'll tell you what's even worse. When people have had to fight for the right to be with their loved ones in hospital. The cruel health orders that tell pregnant women that they have to give birth on their own, and if their husband wants to be there, they've got to apply for an exemption. The cruel health order that told one of our listeners she wasn't allowed to see her husband who's recovering from a severe brain injury. And I'll tell you what else is ridiculous. Treating people who live on their own like second-class citizens. Those in charge refuse to bring in a singles bubble to help the mental fitness of people living solo. And tell me this isn't ridiculous. If you're hooked up with someone on a dating app 24 hours before the lockdown, you can visit each other. But if you've been best mates for 50 years and live more than 10 k's apart, you're not allowed to see each other. You're on your own. Yes, I find that ridiculous too. So to the person who complained because I dared use the word ridiculous, what can I say? Guilty as charged. 131873, the open line number. Now, New South Wales Police will guard a Western Sydney apartment block for the next 2 weeks because multiple residents have been diagnosed with COVID-19. More than 100 residents in the unit block on Devitt Street in Blacktown are now in isolation and police are on guard outside. The Nine News reporter James Wilson is there. James, good morning. Set the scene for us.
Morning, Ben. Well, police are on scene. They've set up a command post. And of course, we saw this in Bondi a few weeks ago. Things like supplies, food and medicine, crucial supplies will need to be brought into these people. It's a big unit block. There's around 50 units in the complex and there's more than 100 residents. We've also seen pathology going in and out. They've tested every single resident. What we know at the moment is there's 5 confirmed cases split across multiple levels. We spoke to one woman, Michelle, who received a test back already. She's thankfully tested negative. But obviously these swabs are still being processed and the sheer scope of this situation is still trying to be understood by the authorities.
There's James Wilson outside the apartment block. Let's go inside right now to Michelle. Hello, Michelle.
Hi.
What's it like inside at the moment?
It's a bit daunting, a bit scary. There's a lot of police outside and we just kind of don't know what's going on right now.
So when you look out your window, what do you see?
I see lots of camera crews. I see a police van, police tape, police cars, police presence, security guards, multiple random people walking around.
So you've been told that police will be outside for 2 weeks. You must all stay inside. Have you been told how you're going to be able to get the essentials? I'm sure that New South Wales Health will step in and sort that out.
Yeah, so they haven't told us that yet. All they've told us is to leave our rubbish outside by 9 a.m. every morning. We haven't been told about the police presence sticking around for 2 weeks, but just assuming that at the moment. All we've been told is about the rubbish, nothing further on the medication, the groceries, how things can be delivered to us yet.
Okay, 5 cases in the building, but you're not one of them. You've returned a negative test.
Yeah, thankfully. Thankfully.
All right, well, hang in there, Michelle. We'll talk to you again, I think. Thanks very much for your time.
You're welcome. Thank you.
So Michelle is one of the residents inside that apartment block on Devitt Street in Blacktown. 100 residents inside, 5 positive cases. And police will now guard that apartment block for the next 2 weeks. No residents are allowed out.
Sydney's best breakfast. Email Ben now at 2gb.com.
It's 18 minutes past 8 on our way to Dawn Fraser. It appears I'm not the only person who finds elements of these lockdowns ridiculous. Frosty says it's ridiculous how the expert health advice changes so much. Leah says, morning Ben, I concur 100%. Well done for voicing what we're thinking. And Edwina says, thanks, Ben. Finally, someone making sense. Nothing is ridiculous based on the comments you just made. So I'm not the only one who finds some elements of the lockdown absolutely bloody ridiculous.
Sydney's best breakfast. 2GB.
Well, well, well. Australia has a new queen of the pool. Ariane Titmus won gold in the 400-metre freestyle. I'm sure everyone's seen it by now. Knocking off the American legend Katie Ledecky. And what about Dawn Fraser? She was there with Ariane's mum and dad, Steve and Robin, watching on as their girl won the gold from the best in the world. Dawn Fraser, good morning to you.
Good morning, Ben. How are you?
I'm doing really well. You sound fantastic. What was it like yesterday being there with the family?
Oh, look, I'm going through goosebumps again, Ben. It was absolutely fantastic, you know, being with the pods. POD stands for the Parents of the Dolphin Swim Team, and I had a beautiful day with them, and you know, it was really great to see all the girls and the boys swimming well, and the men's relay team, And it just opened up the affection that for Australia, that everyone loves Ariana. She's a beautiful young lady, and I mean, so are the rest of the team. And it's probably the best team that we've ever had and sent to an Olympic Games.
Well, that coming from you means a lot. Now, how was the heart?
Pumped a lot. I think I got up to about 156 in a minute.
And for Steve and Robin, I mean, they've really made so many sacrifices, haven't they? They moved from Tasmania, went to Queensland because they wanted to be closer to the coach, Dean Boxall. They really put everything on the line for their daughter.
Yeah, and that's, you know, that's the coach and the pupil doing the best thing possible for them, to both of them. You know, Dean is such a beautiful guy, and his emotions came out yesterday. He's gone right around the world, and, you know, it's sort of, you know, he's brought Ariana up to where she is as a world champion. You know, a little bit did we know when she first came up here to Brisbane, to Queensland, that she started off as a breaststroke swimmer. And she's changed over to a freestyle swimmer and now is the best in the world.
What did you make of Dean's celebration?
Oh, I thought it was absolutely fantastic. In fact, we were all jumping in the room at the same time with him. So, but we didn't have the bar to hang on to go up to do the monster one.
Yeah, well, look, I just thought it was fantastic watching him. That's just pure emotion, right? That's the best of sport.
Absolutely. And you know, it's nice to see a coach have that emotion. And Dean is a very emotional person, as we all saw on the television yesterday, and the tears coming out. I mean, they have achieved something that Mr. Gallagher and I achieved in 1956, coaching, having the best coach in the world and you know, winning a gold medal.
Yeah, and you still give credit where it's due. Now, this isn't the end for Ariane Titmus. We've got more to come. How's she going to go?
Look, I think she'll go pretty well. She mightn't go as well in the 200, but, you know, I never can understand how that young girl, I mean, she had her in the last 100. She had Ledecky all the way, and at 25 metres to go, there was no way in the world Ledecky could try and stay with her. And, you know, she swam her own race. She had planned it, and that's what I like about a swimmer, is that you plan your race, you go in and you do it. You don't worry about your competitors, and that's what we've been trying to mentor with all of the team that's gone away now, is you swim your own race and do the very best that you can.
I saw yesterday a bit of footage of you with Mum and Dad, and did I spot some cocktails that were doing the rounds?
Yeah, they opened a bottle of champagne for them, but I didn't have a drink. Just Grandma and Grandpa and Mum and Dad.
Oh, well, look, we're so happy for you and so happy for them. And, boy, it's good to hear your voice, Dawn. You sound on top of the world.
Well, Ben, who wouldn't be on top of the world with our girls and boys winning gold medals at the Olympic Games in Tokyo? I'm sorry I'm not there, but COVID stopped that, so I'm happy to spend it with the pods.
We love you, Dawn. We'll talk soon. Thanks for your time.
Thanks, Ben. Cheers.
The one and only Dawn Fraser, who won gold in the 100 free at three consecutive Olympics, 56, 60 and 64. And she was there yesterday with Steve and Robin. You imagine that, making the call all those years ago. Okay, let's face it, it's roll of the dice stuff. It's a massive gamble. We're going to pack up our entire life. We're going to move to Queensland, put our faith in this coach, and hope that our girl can swim and become a world champion. Ariane Titmus, we love your work.
Sydney's best breakfast, Ben Fordham Live on 2GB.
26 minutes after 8 o'clock. How good was Dawn Fraser? I mean, I've spoken to Dawn Fraser so many times over the years. I don't think I've ever heard Dawn Fraser as energetic and as focused as she was this morning. And no doubt after what she experienced yesterday, being alongside Ariane Titmus's mum and dad as Ariane brought home the gold. Now, just have a listen to this. The property market, as if it wasn't already off its rocker, the NAB has revised its growth forecast for Sydney property. It now expects prices to grow more than 21% on average this year. 21%. Now, one agent tells me it's almost like the market's gone up a gear since lockdown. On the weekend, we sold 8 out of 10 properties through online auctions. Last week, I sold a house in Mossman for more than $6 million. The buyer was stuck in Noosa and bought it without inspecting in person. So the person stuck in Noosa, they're having a look at video calls, photographs, and they go, oh, well, I may as well grab it. $6 million. So if you're struggling to get into the market, NAB's economists say the impact of low interest rates and government support will eventually wear off and supply will catch up with demand. But still, they're experiencing this massive rush on the property market still. They reckon things will slow down next year to 3% growth, but that's next year. This year, 21% in 1 year in Sydney. So, and obviously there's going to be exceptions to every forecast, but that means if you had a $1 million home in January, it'd be worth 1.2 by year's end. Blows your ears off. Now, I'm not the only person who finds a lot of the elements of the lockdown ridiculous, it turns out. Wayne says, I couldn't agree more. I'm a widower living on my own. I know what it's like. Great comments. Mick says, that's the best I've heard you speak in regards to how ridiculous aspects of the lockdown are. Pete says, thank you for firing up about the lockdown. Please, 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 Premier, spell out the solutions clearly. Someone else said, are you going to organise the next protest? No, I'm not. And I wouldn't go to them because they're unauthorised and illegal. And I said last week to anyone, if you go along to that demonstration, you'll go home in handcuffs or a paddy wagon. It turns out we were right.
People you know. Opinions that matter. News you can trust. This is Breakfast with Ben Fordham on Sydney's 2GB.
A preview of the Ray Hadley Morning Show coming up in the next 10 minutes. But right now...
Tell me what's the word,
Yeah, tell me what's the word, or the words, the cash code words. $1,000 up for grabs. If you know both of them, call 1-300-722-873. That's the competition line, 1-300-722-873. Now, how are you going with support for your business? The New South Wales government says money is starting to hit accounts, but as always, there are stories that say otherwise. People have had to wait more than an hour on the phone to service New South Wales. Others are having trouble figuring out what they're eligible for. So you tell me, are you getting the business support you need? 131873. The New South Wales government tells me 45,000 businesses have now applied for the grant of up to $15,000. They've paid out $156 million. Roughly 20,000 businesses have been approved, with more than half still in the system. And the new payroll injection of up to $10,000 a week is now available. This is JobSaver. 3,500 companies have applied. About half have been approved. However, not every business will apply for it because you've got to guarantee you won't stand down staff. So it will be cheaper for some businesses with larger payrolls to let some people go. You can apply for business support through service.nsw.gov.au. But the feedback from business is overwhelmingly, we need JobKeeper back. Now, speaking of websites, I just gave you that one for Service New South Wales. A few people saying, what's that website that you gave the address for a week or two ago, which is a bit of a shortcut to booking your vaccine? It's hotdoc.com.au. Hotdoc.com.au. So if you go to that website, it works a lot easier than the government websites when it comes to booking a vaccine, because the other ones can take you through all of these different requirements, and then you get to the end of the line and then you find out, oh, hang on a moment, there are none available in my area. That will give you a faster answer. hotdoc.com.au. And I can tell you, as someone who's now fully vaccinated as of yesterday, there is a little bit of a weight that lifts off your shoulders once you know that that's happened. I didn't expect that to happen, but I've certainly experienced that feeling today. Melinda says, I agree with you 1,000% on the ridiculous, cruel, destructive, dishonest lockdown. Good on you for your comments about it. Look, we understand why we have lockdowns, but I also think we need to be ambitious in saying this needs to be our last. And we're keeping an eye on the UK.